Good morning, everyone. I am Rebecca, and with me is Berlin. We are Group 2. And together with us is actually the co-founder of Apper.ph, Diwa Del Mundo.
Hi, good morning.
Well, thank you for giving us time to interview you. Maybe you could walk us through what is Apper.ph.
Okay, sure. So Apper Digital is a cloud consulting company specializing on cloud computing services. So we offer consulting services in the three main cloud computing platforms, namely Amazon Web Services, Google Cloud Platform, and Microsoft Azure. On top of that, we offer services for architecture, migration, implementation, and cloud enablement services.
So more of your customers are more of B2B, given that it's a consulting service.
That's true. Okay. Mm-hmm. So our primary customers are businesses. So mm-hmm. they range from startups to enterprises. So the thing with cloud computing is it's encompassing in terms of scope, right? So anyone who is in the business right now needs some sort of cloud computing services, whether it's in the base infrastructure services, platform as a service, platform services, or even application services. So my background is in technology, so it's in a way it's a natural fit for me to bring my expertise out to the market. That's why we started Apper Digital.
So given the consulting services, do you also offer clients like you're the ones who will be doing the setup, the actual setup of the environment?
Oh yeah, it's cool. So how do we work in Apper? So when we deal with a client, so of course we try to understand what their business is. And for most clients, they hear about this thing called cloud computing. I mean, cloud computing has been there for quite some time. It actually started way back in 2006 when AWS launched, right? So AWS is kind of really started this industry. And so when we engage a client, we talk to them, we try to understand what they're trying to do, mm-hmm. and see if there's a fit, right? And usually enter into scoping and assessment phase. Okay, so that's a formal engagement, really. So it's paid. It's not free or anything.
Okay.
Then that's the first phase. Then second phase, we go with the solutions architecture.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, solutions architecture refers to the development of a solution in the cloud context for a project or product. So that's usually the second phase. And so what you're referring is the phase three, mm-hmm. which is implementation services. So you try to cater with like a lot of setup because companies, right? Since we deal with startups to enterprises, enterprises might have their own IT team or dev team in their company. So usually on that setup, we try to usually our engagement completes after phase two, which is solutions architecture. But for some companies like startups, they call us and say, okay, all right, we like the solutions architecture that you have presented. But we also want you to do it yourselves. we enter another engagement for implementation services.
So maybe before I turn over again the stage to Becca, just one last question.
Okay.
What would you say would be the advantage of Apper.ph as compared to, I believe there are also a lot of cloud computing services companies trying to start up. So
right.
For Apper.ph, given the very nice array of products and services that you offer.
Oh yeah, sure. So our edge is essentially our team is highly certified. On aggregate, we have more than 10 years of experience. Our solutions architecture team is, in terms of experience, very also diverse in terms of the subject and domain expertise. So I have solutions architects with a payment background, information security background, and all software development. So when we engage a client, we can give them the best possible service and also advice.
Right, and especially given that you offer all the three big names for cloud services,
yes.
The customer can be very flexible with
yes, exactly.
That's
okay.
Very nice.
Just one curious question. How did you come up with Apper, the name Apper?
Ah, okay. That's a good question because in terms of our history, it actually started, say, a product-based business
okay.
for digital ID. It's called Tatak Digital ID.
So that's the first?
That's the first.
Tatak Digital ID.
So We started last year, coming from a hackathon.
Okay, so you
won
that hackathon.
Yeah, so we won this hackathon.
Congratulations.
So it's the first Asian Development Bank, Asian Institute of Management hackathon. This was last year. And we won the first place for $10,000 under the digital ID track. Right. So we started with that.
Okay, so Tatak Digital IDs, is it a rebrand
it's a rebrand and ebot. Okay.
The gap between Tatak Digital ID and
Apper
is
it. So I went to PNG January 2019, which is early this year, and Apper formally started as a corporation March. So it's like 2 months of, I guess, soul searching and also pivoting.
Soul searching. I like that.
Because sometimes you need to be realistic too, right?
Yeah.
Especially if you have people in the business already. You can just say that, okay, let's try to soldier on. And experience a lot of pains in the past with past startups, past businesses. So I now have the benefit of experience, and I realized that if you think that the signs are already there, so might as well make it better for everyone rather than try to soldier on with the product or platform that is just going to give you pain in the next several years.
By the way, sir, what's your mission and your vision?
So far as it's bring the cloud to on. That's the vision. It's more of the mission, bring the cloud to all. But the vision is really to enable digital transformation.
So you've mentioned the maturity of the market, the preparedness of the adaptation of the technology. In terms of Apper.ph, how would you identify the market opportunity given that there is a customer need? What are the other identifiers that you use?
So I guess I realized that because I'm a user of cloud services. I started with AWS way back in 2011. Mm-hmm. So during the time, I was working for a tech startup based in Singapore. Mm-hmm. So during the time, I developed a backend video processing application that relied on top of AWS services. I also went to Google for a certification around 2012, I think. And that really opened my mind to the potential of cloud computing services. So the short story is I went back to Manila, worked for a tech startup, and I was heading an engineering team. Mm. And back in 2014, I realized that I know the potential of the cloud services. That's the time I really went deep dive into the cloud technologies, got certified in AWS Certified Solutions Architect. And ever since, I joined the community. I became a cloud community leader in the AWS user group back in 2014. And because of my involvement in the community, I became aware of the opportunity.
So in terms of, for example, identifying the customers, how do you target them? Do you get customers through referrals or marketing?
Okay. So good question. Because so we have business pillars. So we have the consulting, which is our primary business pillar, and we also have coaching services. Right. The reason we structured it that way is because, as I said earlier before, we want to adapt to the configuration or to the setup of the customer. Because when you go to a customer, you can't just, let's say, develop something, a service or a product, and hope that they're gonna fit into what they're offering. So I think the key here is that you need to be as flexible as possible. So by structuring the business into like pillars, it allowed us to adapt. So right now we deal with startups, but we can also handle enterprises.
So it seems like your tactic is more of giving additional value to the customers and helping them migrate to the cloud, or what else are your other tactics in terms of grabbing them and, of course, maintaining the customers as well?
Yeah. Because I think it's a journey, right? So, I mean, as I said before, the flexibility needs to be there. Because when you look at customers, sometimes they might be starting and they might need certain things, right, to get into a certain level. Mm-hmm. So we're always there to support them. So that's why we have the consulting and the coaching services to enable their team. And moving forward, once they have deployed or once they have implemented their platform or product, we go in for their platform services, for managed services. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the way I see it is, moving forward, the market will be ready for more advanced digital services like the digital ID.
Right.
Maybe sometime in the future, we'll revisit that. But the key here is that you adapt to the needs of the customer. And we look at our customers, they're under a journey, right?
So if you don't mind, can we ask you about the funding? Like, do you tie up with venture capitalists?
So we bootstrap the company.
Mm-hmm.
So when we decided to pivot from a product-based company to a services company, we really bootstrapped it. Since our product is in a way, there's a clear and a clear direction. In a way, especially at the start, it kind of our initial revenue really helped run the company, so we don't need to accept huge fundings from a VC. Actually, I don't want to work with a VC, if possible. But we did have an investor, so the investor also helped us. We're in a pre-seed, but if you look at it from the funding perspective, we're considered as a pre-seed. Because everything's not validated yet.
Mm-hmm.
But what I've seen is as we get more success, we were able to close a major account, which is Globe Telecom.
Yes.
That validated our business.
Mm-hmm.
So in a way, if ever we need to raise capital, that's really for expansion. But
mm-hmm.
I think at this point of time, since because of my experience in the tech startups industry, is if you try to accept money, there's always a catch. And for me, having the ability to really control the company is very important. Because I've seen it all over in the asset.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes, not necessarily if you accept money, you'll be successful. It might be that you might even get the wrong direction.
Your company.
You can destroy the business.
So this business, this company, is it a family-owned business?
Yeah, I had my another
friend's business.
I had key members in our company as co-founders, as family members.
Family.
I think it just happened that most of us have the right background.
Mm-hmm.
So my brother is a product designer, so he's the one developing the front end, the logos, the decks,
mm-hmm.
everything. So my wife, naman, she's into technology then. So she's an iOS developer. So we have a really strong technical background from the get-go. And my other sister, my sister has a business and finance background. So she's also an alumna of UP, tapos MBA from AIM. And she's the one looking at the finances and capital and business perspective. But we also need to get more key expertise, right? So Patrick's, our co-founder, is really into the marketing and branding. So we're trying to build the company. The family members have the key expertise to start a company. Again, for me, it's not about the size, but it's also about the multiplier. I'm very particular with the quality of the people.
Yeah.
It's not really about quantity. Because if the person is more proficient, with the amount of technologies we have, if you do things correctly, you don't need as much as you don't need that many people. So ganun din apply ko concept dito. So you get the right people kasi everything will then follow through. If you get the wrong people, then that's it, finish na.
What kind of challenges yung na-face mo, and ano yung mga nagawa niyo to overcome?
It's a good question. Because initially, since I also thought of getting some key partners, some of them will pitch in some amount of money, some key expertise. So I talked to a lot of people earlier this year, and when they displayed them the deck, what is this? So a lot of rejections.
Mm-hmm.
So a cold approach, sa isang conference,
mm-hmm.
I introduced myself, tapos gusto nila, sige, let's talk. So nakita nila. Okay. It's not it.
You actually really grow your network.
I mean, sometimes you really need to, really go into the battle of, akpalin mo talaga mukha, you'll get a straight no, or, wala talaga, zero. So, those are the key challenges, accepting the no's over and over.
So, looks like from everything that you've stated, from the start, you already have the vision, you're going on traction with where you're going. Let's talk about Apper.ph, let's say 3 to 5 years from now. How would you see Apper.ph scale eventually as the time goes?
So what we're trying to build talaga is a really solid tech consulting company mm-hmm. that really understand product and tech. Mm-hmm. And the best people to really start a business like that are the people who came from a generation na may digital. So I think our generation really understand that. And I think that's very important to have. I think 5-10 years from now, the landscape is very different. So going to that future, I think that's challenging for most businesses. Mm-hmm. But we're there to really guide them on how to understand technology and apply it to their businesses, to apply to give value. Yun yung pinaka-important principle.
What was your most expensive resource and then yung parang biggest bulk of the investment that you've placed on, given that you already have the expertise, eh? So no need to invest on training, probably on the technology maybe?
Yeah, so in a way, the investment, so we're a services company, so it means that our people is our largest resource, so that's the major thing. The investment, kasi essentially, my entire experience essentially was the entire investment. Because mm-hmm. I think I won't be able to do this if I didn't have the right experiences and also the community experience. Lahat yan culminated, and I feel like that's the key investment. And it's more of an investment of time, getting to know the right people to help you with, getting to know the technology.
So right now, given that you're already
full-time
on the startup, could you describe us your typical day from when you get up to the morning?
So our work days goes Monday to Saturday. So I try to rest pag Sunday talaga. Mm-hmm. So one thing I realized over the years, since I work with a lot of tech startups and I've seen it all over, you need to manage your stress and your mental health then. And I feel like in the tech industry, especially with startup founders, there are a lot of issues pagdating sa mental health. Kasi the amount of pressure that you need to endure. Especially once you start a business, kasi na-raise ko nga rin din. If you're employed kasi, you have a boss, diba? You're part of the boss. Isang tao lang yan. Kapag may business ka pala, everyone is your boss na. Okay, so your customers, your partners, your investors, your... even your co-founders, your internal team, wala ka na talaga. You need to have that mindset talaga how to effectively handle all of those.
How would you define success?
Success?
Very deep. Very universal. So do you find yourself successful? Do you see yourself?
At a certain level. I feel like, I guess the validation of the business, because you have customers, you have validation, feedback from customers. We're able to have success stories.
Yes.
So you can say that there's a certain level of success na siguro. I guess yung success kasi, I feel like it's relative siguro.
Mm-hmm.
I think we have a certain level of success na which we're very happy naman. But I feel like there's so much more. So again, I guess the finish success is also moving part tech.
Never ends.
Yeah. And after you get to this level, okay, any next. I mean, it's psychological, and I think it's well documented. It's always moving.
Do you have any advice for the aspiring entrepreneurs?
Aspiring, I know.
for us,
I guess the advice is prepare yourself for a lot of hardships. I feel like, I guess an analogy here is sometimes kasi we deal with you know, the younger crowd. Technically, millennial pa rin naman ako. As a boundary kasi ako. Pero we have a lot of students namin sa program namin sa camp for, ano, and sometimes we try to make it easy for people to understand the concepts. So what do we mean by that? Kasi, ano ba, sa context ng relationships, di ba? Parang, there are days na parang puro hurt lang yung, or you feel like, ano ba, ang dami kang nararamdaman. But you apply it in a professional context. So rejections, yung any mga hardships, lack of funding, or you feel like yung existentialist na dread na okay, tama ba itong ginagawa na? Diba? So you need to power through all of those, diba? And that's the hardest for me, that's the hardest thing. And you need to hindi siya yung tipong ano, pag employee ka kasi syempre ako dati nag-employee ako and I've experienced na okay, a lot of hardships ng isang week. Okay, shit, todo tayo, pupukan para ma-release or magawa, whatever. Tapos, hey, ano na, weekend na. Woo, parang
yes, wala.
Wala na, tapos na. Oh, okay, parang gano'n na, diretso na, ano tayo, weekend getaway na. When you start a business, walang gano'n. So ako, for example, pag sabi tayo, hey, Friday na. Tapos kinabukasan, actually, mag-start pa lang yun, ano? Yung program namin Saturdays. And experienced that recently lang. Wednesday to Friday, we're with the Globe Cloud Enablement, Accelerated Cloud Connection and Enablement Program. Pagpupan yan. Tapos, Friday night, we have a program tomorrow pala. I need to hold. I'm handling one of the, ano kasi, we have a newly launched program. It's called the Cloud Developer Mentorship Program for AWS Certified Developer Associate. Since the first run, ako muna yung mag-handle. So I need to prepare. So natapos kami sa Globe program, mga 6 or 7. So mag-start pala ako. Kailangan, mag-prepare ako. And then, tulog na ako mga 3 or 4. Tapos I need to be in the, our, in one corporate center, penthouse. That's where we hold the program. Nandun na ako by 7:30. So, ano yan. So, parang feeling mo tapos ka na. So mag-start pala ako ng isa. So, but over time, once I get how to operationalize it, that's when I can delegate. Darating yung point na yan, but at this point of time, since we're a startup business, I need to make sure every product and service naman muna sa akin. Para kita ko agad ko ano yung product, ano yung pain points, ano yung improvements ka lang gawin. So it never ends. So, enduring hardships, I think that's the advice siguro. Parang relationship lang naman. During hardships.
Yes. Thank you very much for the insights.
Hi everyone, my name is Diwa Del Mundo, co-founder, president, and principal cloud architect of Apper Digital Incorporated. So thank you for the UP Technology Management Center for this interview. I'm really happy and also blessed with the questions and this is a very interesting experience for me. So thank you and good luck in your future businesses.